At this time, we ask that you please silence all electronics and refrain from using flash photography for the duration of the ceremony. Please be aware that following the roll call of the absent, there will be a 21-gun salute. Thank you.
Let us pray. As Aggies come together in all parts of the world, we pause to give thanks for the many blessings we have received. We are grateful for our Aggie heritage and the fellowship we have because of those who have come before us. Strengthen this sense of love and community. May it spread to men and women of all schools, nations, and races, and bring the people of the world closer together. Fill this ceremony with the bond of love and family that is broken by an absence in our roll call. May we have a reverent appreciation for the great examples and sacrifices given by those whom we honor by silver taps. Bless the inspiration of this occasion, that we may be strong in body, keen in mind, selfless in all that we do, and deeply rooted in the values we hold dear. Amen.
Good evening, and please be seated. Tonight, I would like to welcome you all to Aggie Muster. This evening, we feel both the joy of reunion and the sorrow of loss. I believe that within the tradition of Aggie Muster, the Aggie family encapsulates the whole spectrum of human emotion. We gather not only in sorrow for the Aggies lost, but also with the joy of having lived with them and gratitude for having known and loved them. As we pause to gather, remember, and celebrate, I hope that you will all join me in taking in the special nature of this tradition. This muster is just one of many, unique to our community and tied by the Aggie spirit to every muster around the world. The spirit of muster transcends space and time, making each muster as special as what we feel here tonight. I would like to take a moment to acknowledge all of those who have gathered here this evening. To the class of 1969, welcome back to Aggie Land. It is one of our greatest joys as Aggies to share in a comradeship that connects us across both miles and generations. Though Texas A&M may look a bit different, it is my hope that you have felt the Aggie spirit as present as ever. We are honored to have you here with us and hope that we have made you proud as the torchbearers of your legacy at Texas A&M and beyond. I would like to extend a special welcome to the current student body, especially those of you who are experiencing your first muster. Not only do all of you represent the present of Aggieland, but also the future of Texas A&M and muster. I encourage you to embrace this tradition wherever life may take you. Muster is the lifelong tradition of every Aggie and surpasses even life itself. This is only the beginning of your muster journey. To the Aggie family at large, all those former students and friends who have joined us here tonight, I have no doubt that you have come from far and wide, and it is truly the spirit of muster that draws us together. Finally, I would like to welcome the honored families. We hope that you feel, through the love that fills this place tonight, that we are alongside you in your loss. There are few things in life harder than losing a loved one, and as Aggies, we choose not to ignore this sorrow, but rather to bring it into the light. It is my hope that the darkness that entered your life with the passing of your Aggie will be somewhat replaced by the light of every candle here this evening. Tonight, your loved one will be acknowledged once more, gone but most certainly not forgotten from this family. As we gather in honor of what it means to be an Aggie and in honor of the unity that this family promises in times of joy and sorrow, I am reminded of the words of former President George Herbert Walker Bush, who said, "To be bold in your caring, be bold in your dreaming, and above all else, always do your best." In being here tonight, we as Aggies are bold in our care for one another, and we are most certainly doing our best not to forget any and all who make up our Aggie family. I truly thank you all for choosing to be here tonight. On behalf of the Aggie Muster Committee and the Texas A&M campus community, it is my sincere pleasure to welcome you all to the 2019 Campus Muster.
It is my honor to be with you tonight. I want to welcome current and former students, faculty and staff, families and friends of Texas A&M. Thank you for being here. Tonight may be your first muster or one of many, but I find no matter how many times I stand here at muster, each and every year it is a remarkable witness of the shared respect and love Aggies have for one another. It truly is a family, a lifelong bond, displayed in amazing fashion at muster here on campus, and over 300 other musters, large and small, around the world. Last year, I stood in this spot and spoke about the internment of First Lady Barbara Bush. It took place on our campus on the very day of muster. Then, in late November, we lost her beloved husband. George H.W. Bush lies beside Barbara and their daughter, Robin. It's a beautiful spot on the grounds of the Bush Presidential Library and Museum. Mutual love and respect between Aggies and the Bush family was tremendous. They would watch last December, the entire world watched last December, as President Bush arrived in College Station for one last time. And as the casket was removed from the train, the Aggie war hymn played. Many were surprised by this, as the war hymn is somewhat upbeat and not exactly a funeral march. But we know that it was a special request by the president himself, a final gesture to the Aggies he so dearly loved, a final I love you from the Bush family. Tonight, we will call the names of both George and Barbara Bush, and it will be our great honor to answer here. Sitting among us tonight are members of the class of 1969, on campus for their 50th year reunion. Several years ago, the class of 69 launched a legacy fund supporting Aggies throughout our college, from fish camp to graduation. As part of the effort, they created Spirit Plaza as a gift to all Aggies, past, present, and future. We'll officially dedicate that plaza tomorrow, but it features monuments, including one especially poignant. It's a gift from the class of 1972. This marker is dedicated to three students who were killed in an automobile accident on a core trip to Dallas in the fall of 1968. The students we lost were Cadet Donald Cowart, 72, his CO, John Groves, class of 69, and George Reynolds, class of 72. The marker has a replica of letters that was written by one of the students, Fish Donald Cowart, to his parents just 3 weeks before he was killed. Donald wrote the letter to his parents after experiencing his first silver taps in the fall of 1968. In it, he wrote as follows. I've experienced tonight what A&M is all about, mother and dad. We're one big family up here, and I know what it means to be an Aggie. Not long after, Donald himself was honored at Silver Taps, along with John Groves and George Reynolds. This letter has since been read many times to incoming freshmen as a lesson from the past about the power of the Aggie spirit as it looks to the future. Thank you to the classes of 1969 and 72 and all those who came together to create the Spirit Plaza to honor Silver Taps, muster the Aggie Honor Code, and our core values. It'll be fulfilling to see the campus community and visitors experience these stirring reminders. And finally, to the families of the Aggies being honored here tonight. While many of us may be unknown to you, your loved one was part of our family too. Tonight we mourn with you, but we also celebrate lives well lived, so all of our lives are better lives of love, of compassion, of integrity, of servants. Lives lived as Aggies. May our love and remembrance this evening be of great comfort to you and all those who knew and loved your Aggie, and a reminder that they will never be forgotten. Their legacy will be remembered and honored. They will always be here. Thank you.
Howdy, and welcome to Aggie Muster. Tonight is special for so many reasons. One personal reason is that speaking here tonight is my last official duty as student body president. I would like to use this time to tell you my own Aggie Muster story because I believe it authentically depicts just how special tonight really is. As a sophomore at Texas A&M and a first-generation Aggie, I long to know the Aggie spirit. I felt the Aggie family, and I certainly loved our university, but I had never truly embraced the spirit that can ne'er be told. I decided that in my quest to know the spirit for myself, I would apply to become a muster host and help lead and support the families who had lost loved ones, like many here tonight, throughout the ceremony. Part of this role included leading bus tours around campus for the 50th class year reunion, which I was particularly excited for. Loading one of the last buses with about 10 reunion class members and myself, I was ready to answer any questions about what it's like to be on campus 50 years later. Little did I know that I was actually going to be the one learning on this bus ride. A man was seated next to me for the duration of the tour. We laughed as he told me stories of old Army and the clever tricks he played on upperclassmen in the core dorms. I listened intently when he shared his experience flying planes for the United States Air Force in Vietnam. And I smiled when he waved goodbye as I dropped him off for lunch at the end of the tour. I couldn't believe how much fun I had visiting with that old ag, and I wished that our friendship could have lasted longer than a brief 45 minutes. Nonetheless, I was happy to have known him, even for a short time. Fast forward to that evening, after I had seated my two families and found my way to my seat. I picked a random row and sat somewhere in the middle by myself, scanning through the program. Just as the choir began their first hymn, I looked over to my right and saw a man holding his candle and instructions alone. As I looked closer, I realized that I recognized the man. He played tricks on upperclassmen as a student, flew airplanes in Vietnam with his brothers in arms, and now sat alone in Reed Arena. I glanced around for his family or his designated guest, but no one was near him. With a brief flush of courage, I walked over to him and asked if anyone was coming to join him. He shook his head no, and when I asked if I could join him, his eyes told me yes. When he lit his candle and closed his eyes to honor his loved one, I felt in the deepest place of my heart the Aggie spirit that everyone had told me about. At the end of the ceremony, I thanked him for letting me be a part of his experience, and with tear-filled eyes, he leaned down for a huge hug. In his embrace, I knew that with the solemn answers to the roll call, the Aggie spirit was felt by us both, bringing comfort and peace with each steady hear. This feeling is replicated by thousands across the globe as we all partake in A&M's most beloved and venerated tradition. From our first howdy to our comrades answering here, our hearts are full with love, respect, and loyalty for our family. As I reach the close of my final semester as an undergraduate student at Texas A&M, I am confronted with many lasts. Last fight in Texas Aggie football season in the student section, last time taking an exam at Mays Business School, last time watching the Corps of Cadets march across O.R. Simpson with my friends among the ranks. I am comforted, however, by the fact that this will not be my last muster. Life may take me far away from Kyle Field, far away from midnight study sessions at the library, far away from Aggieland sunsets, but no matter where I go in the world, I will never be too far away to answer here for those lost among our Aggie family. I feel deep comfort in knowing that someday, maybe next muster, or maybe at the muster 75 years from now, my name will be called when I am absent, and with profound strength and love for our family, the Aggies will answer here. Tonight, we feel two immeasurable things. We feel the immeasurable loss in the Aggie spirit for each soul absent from our sides. And we feel the immeasurable love those Aggies held for our university and for the families that love them so well. As the Aggies call here for the name of every lost one loved tonight, let memories of their lives fill your mind, warm your heart, and lead you through. On behalf of the student body of Texas A&M, I offer my sincerest condolences for the loss of your loved one and pray that you find strength in the love and warm embrace of our Aggie family. Please stand for the singing of the 12th man.
Texas Aggies down in Aggie land, we've got Aggie spirit to a man. Stand united, that's the Aggie theme. We're the 12th man on the team. When we're down, the going's rough and tough, we just grin and yell, we've got the stuff to fight together for the Aggie dream. We're the 12th man on that fighting Aggie team. Texas Aggies down in Aggie land. We've got Aggie spirit to our man. Stand united, that's the Aggie
Maybe seated. Howdy, I'm Mark Fisher, chairman of the board of the Association of Former Students. What a privilege to be in Aggie land for muster, what I believe to be the most sacred and time-honored tradition at Texas A&M. It's my sincere pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the premier alumni organization in the world, the Association of Former Students. I want to recognize especially the former students from the class of 69 who are joining us on campus for their 50-year class reunion. We are honored to have you and your families with us, and we sincerely thank you for all that you mean to Texas A&M. As we gather in College Station this evening, we are joined by Aggies in more than 300 locations around the world as we remember those for whom we answer here and celebrate the unique spirit which binds us together. Whether it is a formal event such as the one we are experiencing tonight, or an impromptu gathering in a community center or a combat zone, every muster event concludes with friends and families proudly answering the roll call for our departed loved ones. What a tribute this is to our Aggie family. Tonight, our roll call in Reed Arena honors our campus community. Yesterday afternoon, however, in the Clayton W. Williams Jr. Alumni Center, my wife Susu and I joined with President Young, Chancellor John Sharp, class of 72, our campus muster speaker, Dr. Robiler, class of 84, members of the campus muster executive committee, and other former student representatives in calling the names and answering here for all 1,600 Aggies included on the worldwide muster roll call for the absent. We were truly touched and honored to have been part of this special roll call. Muster is indeed a powerful reflection of our renowned Aggie spirit and a testament to our worldwide Aggie network, which includes students, former students, parents, faculty, staff, and friends of Texas A&M. Thank you to everyone here and to all Aggies gathering around the world today who continue to lead the Aggie network and make Muster a true global phenomenon. Our association takes great pride in your work, and we so greatly appreciate your dedication to Texas A&M. I hope each of us will leave here this evening with a deeper appreciation for Texas A&M and the core values that guide us, the individuals with whom we have shared our Aggie journey, and our commitment to keep them present in our hearts. Muster is a sacred promise that continues because of the dedication, reverence, and character displayed by Aggies past and present. Thank you, and God bless.
Tonight, we have the privilege of welcoming the class of 1969 back to Aggieland for their 50-year class reunion. This class has witnessed and often paved the way for decades of change at this university. So tonight, we will take a moment to reflect on our beloved campus as it was 50 years ago, but also look to the future as the class of 1969 continues to leave a legacy at Texas A&M University. 50 years ago, campus and College Station looked very different than they do today. With limited entertainment in town, the students frequently conspired to make their own fun. They can tell you stories of epic dining hall food fights, BB guns shot stealthily across the quad at upperclassmen, and even a massive water balloon slingshot mounted on top of Duncan Dining Hall. In the mid-1960s, President Rutter enacted sweeping changes to the university. The Corps of Cadets became non-compulsory, and the first women and students of color were admitted. The class of 1969 features some of the first female leaders of student organizations, the first Hispanic Corps commander, and the first African American to graduate as a member of the Corps of Cadets. This class saw the greatest achievements of Rutter's presidency, and also its end, as he passed away a few months following graduation. The class of 1969 is the last class with General Rutter's signature on their diploma. While the class of 1969 undoubtedly has many fond memories of their time on campus, many of them knew following graduation they would be called to serve in Vietnam. Many members of the class served with distinction. 11 members of the class were killed while serving on active duty, including Captain Ronald W. Forrester, who is still listed as missing in action. A black granite monument now stands outside the quad commemorating these Aggies and their dedication to our country. Since their time on campus, members of the class of 1969 have made a lasting impact on this university and the world. The class includes military officers, community leaders, entrepreneurs, politicians, and civil servants. The class of 1969 is particularly proud to collectively serve as the Fish Camp crew namesake and sponsor each year. As we honor these distinguished Aggies, we also look to the future. Tomorrow, April 23rd, the class of 1969 will be dedicating the Spirit Plaza as a means of perpetuating the traditions at the very core of this university, Silver Taps and Muster. As an extension of Academic Plaza, these monuments will share with visitors and students alike why we gather in the dark to honor our own, as we have for the past 50 years and will for the next 50 years. The class of 1969 will entrust the site to the class of 2019, and we will in turn trust its care to the class of 2069 at our own 50-year reunion. As the class of 1969 once again says howdy to Aggieland, we also pause to say here and mark present in our hearts those Aggies who did not live to see their 50th reunion. Though much has changed in the past 50 years, the Aggie spirit has not. We are still bound as a family by our traditions, core values, loyalty to one another, and a love for this university. As a group who truly embodies these qualities of an Aggie, it is an honor to welcome the class of 1969 back to Aggieland.
When the muster committee asked Dr. Dwight Robler, with the help of his wife, Kathy, to be the campus muster speaker this year, the first thing we heard was, "You must have got the wrong guy." To which he then turned to his wife and said, "Were you in on this too?" His humility assured us and spoke even more as to why we knew that he was our guy. And I can assure you that he's most likely still demonstrating that same humility on stage behind me. By spending his entire life dedicated to continually learn and selflessly serve our country, our Aggie family, and the world around him, Dwight Robler is someone I am proud to have the honor of introducing as our muster speaker tonight. Someone who in his own way has made a difference in the lives of many, many Aggies. Dwight arrived in Aggieland as the first generation Ag in 1980. As a National Merit Scholar and under the President's Endowed Scholarship, he started his time at Texas A&M as a physics major and a fish in the Corps of Cadets. He would later become commander of the Squadron 9 Hellcat. Upon graduating as a distinguished graduate of Texas A&M's Air Force ROTC, he commissioned into the United States Air Force, where he would serve up until his retirement 26 years later as colonel. As a second lieutenant, Dwight entered space operations for the Air Force. He then served in space-based missile warning operations at Space Command Headquarters, Air Force Headquarters, and the Joint Staff. Dwight returned to Texas A&M, where he would later earn his PhD in political science in 2009. Following his retirement from the Air Force, Dwight returned to Aggieland once again to continue his teaching career, now as a lecturer for Texas A&M's Department of Political Science. After the first week of lecturing to Aggie undergraduates, Dwight came home to Kathy and told her that he knew that he had found his calling. Those that know Dwight as an instructor knows that he goes above and beyond as an educator. As he is fond of saying to each of the 7,000 students who have attended his classes, "I am working for your success." Earlier this month, I got to witness Dr. Robler receive the Partners in Learning ACE Award. There, I had the opportunity to hear testimonies from his students speaking about how he fosters a welcoming, inclusive environment in his classroom, ensuring that each student doesn't feel like just a number amongst many. Many students even know of Dr. Robler for opening up his home for Thanksgiving each year to students staying in Aggieland over the break. His house, much like his classroom, is a home, better yet, a haven for many. Students are just another extension of his family, and it is certainly a big family. 33 years ago, Dwight married his bride, Kathleen Robler. Together, they have 8 children: Andrew and Patrick, both Aggies; Emma, Kanya, Daniel, Andrea, Chance, and their late son, Randy. Dwight is devoted to Kathy, their 8 children, along with their life partners, 6 beloved grandchildren, and 3 lovely dogs. Big family, right? And so tonight, Dwight is joined by members of his family, several of his classmates, friends, and core buddies from the class of 1984, and you, Aggie family. In 2017, he was honored as a Fish Camp namesake, Session D Blue Camp Robler. And in 2018, he was recognized by the Office of Residence Life with an Honorary Excellence Award. Dwight has spoken at new student conferences and currently serves on the Texas A&M Aggie Honor Council. Dwight Robler truly has been and continues to be a wonderful representation and embodiment of the Aggie spirit. This year's ceremony is made especially meaningful for Dwight, as former President George H.W. Bush, one of our honorees tonight, served as his commencement speaker for his graduation, as well as his commander-in-chief for the duration of his entire presidency while he was on active duty Air Force. In just a few moments, you will hear from a man who cherishes family, who cherishes tradition, and who cherishes Texas A&M. It has been a pleasure and an honor to get to know this incredible man. And tonight, Aggie family, it is my great privilege to introduce the 2019 Campus Muster Speaker, Dwight Robler, Class of 84.
Howdy. I bring greetings to all of you from 4 generations of the Robler family here tonight. I also join in welcoming the family members and friends who have come from near and far to answer the roll call for the absent in honor and memory of those they have lost. I welcome members of the 50-year reunion class of 1969, a close-knit group of Aggies who continue to nurture their relationships. Some of them do so at their weekly Ags and Bacon breakfast gathering, which I was kindly invited to attend a few weeks ago. This class has given a generous gift of the new Spirit Plaza and its monuments to mark our most sacred Aggie traditions, including muster. But tonight, no matter whether this is our first or our 100th time here at Texas A&M University, we all are family. We all are welcome. I also want to thank the 30 remarkable students of the Muster Committee who graciously placed their faith in me when they invited me to speak tonight. I and my family have thoroughly enjoyed getting to know them during this semester. They are a most impressive group of Aggies, simultaneously operating from a compassionate reverence for the relationships we will remember and celebrate this evening, as well as an awesome drive to make this a muster to remember. And what a magnificent thing they've created. From concept to delivery, marked with thousands of hours of passionate effort, this muster is a heartfelt gift from these 30 students to all of us here tonight. Muster is a unique occasion. Only a group of Aggies would conceive of combining a somber memorial service for hundreds of lost loved ones with a boisterous family reunion boasting tens of thousands of guests. Muster is a joyous celebration and a somber remembrance. What we do here tonight is echoed in well over 300 other locations, as far away as Australia, Kazakhstan, Estonia, Saudi Arabia, and wherever two or more Aggies have gathered. Each muster honors those Aggies who have died during the past year, but live on in the hearts and minds of those in attendance. There have been many, many musters before tonight. Musters were held during World War II and the conflicts in Korea, Vietnam, and Iraq, during which Aggies served in harm's way and far too many paid with their lives. Muster was held the spring after the bonfire stack collapsed on November 18, 1999, and we lost 12 of our own. Muster was held in 2002 after the terrorist strikes of 9/11 had killed three Aggies and thousands of others, and our entire nation feared an unknown future. Musters since that year have honored the growing list of Aggies who died during the ongoing war on terror. Musters through the years have also honored those who have battled physical and mental illnesses, those whose lives have ended suddenly and tragically, and those who have died peacefully at the end of a long life. To muster means to assemble. "Sergeant, muster the troops," would have been a common order a number of years ago. However, the title of tonight's event can also be used in the sense of mustering courage. Both of these meanings are appropriate, for on this day, Aggies assemble to revel and to remember all that they love about Texas A&M and the Aggie family. But most importantly, we also come to be with the muster families who daily find the courage to continue on in the wake of great loss. Muster is central within the Aggie universe, but there is a lot to love about Texas A&M. Aggies love our traditions. Silver taps, midnight yell, elephant walk, and muster are just a few that are unique among universities worldwide. Aggies love our student-run organizations and events like Fish Camp, freshman leadership organizations, the Corps of Cadets, Greek Life, the Big Event, and over 1,000 more. In these organizations, Aggies learn and hone the fundamentals of teamwork that will make them exceptional contributors and leaders in their chosen communities and professions. Aggies love the athletic programs at Texas A&M. We love winning. Although we realize that we will occasionally be outscored or run out of time just before we most certainly would have been victorious. And Aggies love academics. Texas A&M is a tier one university, a world-class institution, a top leader in the academy of teaching, learning, and discovering through research. We don't just learn and leverage existing knowledge, but we create new knowledge, building upon the foundation laid by those who came before us. We share knowledge in order to make a difference in the lives of our community, nation, and the world. As a social scientist, I look at these parts of Aggie life, traditions, organizations, athletics, and academics, and I see a common thread. In each of these aspects of Aggie life, relationships are at the center. I hold many different perspectives on the Aggie experience. I am a former student twice over, a parent to several Aggies, a current faculty member, and a member of the Brazos Valley community. So these are the lenses through which I would want us to look at muster tonight, as a time to honor and celebrate Aggie relationships, past, present, and future. First, we look to the past and honor those Aggies lost to family, friends, and the Aggie community during the last year. Those who knew and loved each of these Aggies will mark their memory by answering here during the roll call for the absent. There is power in remembering. I want to read a passage written by Frederick Buechner in his book, Whistling in the Dark. When you remember me, it means that you have carried something of who I am with you, that I have left some mark of who I am on who you are. It means that you can summon me back to your mind, even though countless years and miles may stand between us. It means that if we meet again, you will know me. It means that even after I die, you can still see my face and hear my voice and speak to me in your heart. For as long as you remember me, I am never entirely lost. When I'm feeling most ghost-like, it's your remembering me that helps remind me that I actually exist. When I'm feeling sad, it's my consolation. When I'm feeling happy, it's part of why I feel that way. If you forget me, one of the ways I remember who I am will be gone. If you forget me, part of who I am will be gone. As a son and a father who is familiar with the ache and grief of loss, I join with all those surrounding our Muster families tonight to say that we are here to remember you with your loved ones now lost. Some of us personally knew your family member. Others of us were only introduced this week as we solemnly viewed the reflection displays many of you so caringly provided. We cannot comprehend the depth or the breadth of your experience since your loss, but we are committed to helping you honor those you love, as well as helping you to recall the happy memories of them that are tied to their time in Aggieland. As the spirit of Aggieland reminds us, the bond of friendship and family makes us unique and keeps us strong. We are the Aggies. The Aggies are we, true to each other, as Aggies should be. Those just getting to know us might think that these words are no different than the songs of any other alma maters. However, the spirit of Aggieland reflects on our long and storied past to remind us constantly of who we are now. Second, when we consider who we are in the present, we find ourselves indebted to our current Aggie relationships. We should probably all have a large Aggie under construction sign hanging around our necks to remind us of the importance of honoring the contributions others are making to our lives day by day. Who we are at this moment is not just the result of our own accomplishments mixed with a bit of good fortune, but it is the product of many great and small gifts given at just the right time, through goodness and generosity of others in the Aggie community. These are gifts of exceptional value because they are exactly what we need at that moment. Opportunities we did not think possible. Second chances when we've fallen and have trouble starting again. Words of encouragement when we feel unimportant and worthless. Inclusion as family, even by those different from ourselves or with whom we disagree. A listening ear when life is caving in and we need to sort things out. Words of advice that cut through our confusion and indecision. Words of caution or warning when we are about to do or say something we will regret. These gifts give us the stamina to carry on, the insight to seek wisdom, and the confidence to take risks for something great. We become our best selves because these gifts are bequeathed through present relationships. I have studied at this university twice for the sum total of 7.5 years. During those years, I benefited from the kindness and generosity of others as they met me wherever I was. Although past now, these were present relationships when I was a student, and they impacted me profoundly. I came to Texas A&M for my graduate degree because David Reck, class of 84, shared his love of Texas A&M throughout our time in high school. Steve Sisney, class of 82, graduated high school 2 years before me and paved the way in Aggieland, sending back word that it was all we had hoped it would be. Dr. Sandy Hartsfield, Platts of 70, and his wife, Jenny Hartsfield, taught a college class at church and took a personal interest in each student. Their hospitality and support gave me a much needed respite from life on campus during the hard times. Dr. Nelson Duller, class of 48, was a faculty member and well-respected scholar in the physics department, as well as my undergraduate academic advisor. In my junior year, I was overwhelmed by the competing responsibilities of the Corps of Cadets and my physics coursework. I went to Dr. Duller in desperation, fearing failure, humiliation, loss of my scholarships, and risk to my upcoming military commission. He responded with patience, kindness, wisdom, and strategic thinking. He helped me adjust my degree plan so I would graduate on time and uphold my responsibilities. I left his lab shaking my head in wonder. He transformed my doom-filled outlook to one of hope and encouragement. During my senior year, I was befriended by Old Man Al. He was a retired missionary whose self-appointed job was to care for students in the Corps. Al's supportive and non-judgmental friendship helped me keep my head high and sights level to prepare for life after graduation. Through all of my undergraduate years, four of my fish buddies and the best non-reg friend that anyone could ask for were there to encourage, cajole, sweat, and share the experiences of life on and off the quad. Steve, Scotty, Bob, Eric, and Greg, thanks for being there with me through it all. We are also mindful that this musters the 25th anniversary of when we all answered here for our close friend and fellow cadet, John Romero Jr., class of 84. 22 years after my first graduation from Texas A&M, in fall 2006, I was a full colonel. My head was spinning and my heart was sinking during my first doctoral seminars. What in the world had I been thinking when I decided to jump into a PhD program in political science in order to teach for the Air Force? It had been 14 long years since I had earned my master's degree. I had no background in political science theory. I did know how to buckle down and gut it out when faced with a tough situation. But faculty and staff members like Nehemia Gava, Ken Meyer, Mike Cook, Eric Godwin, and Llewellyn Dozier kept me focused and moving forward through the program. Without them and so many others, I would not be here teaching today. And then there are the many Aggies present day who infuse my life here with joy, with purpose and challenge. Students, staff, faculty, administrators, former students, friends, neighbors, and family. Each of us in this room tonight owes much gratitude to people who are accompanying us, challenging us, helping us, encouraging us, and making us more today than we were yesterday. Maybe this is one of the secrets as to why Aggies are so well known for their achievements and accomplishments, because each Aggie, in a way, is crowdsourced. The benefactor of the accumulated investment of so many members of the Aggie family. Third, we might consider the promise of relationships with those who will become the Aggies of the future, sitting in classrooms, practicing yells, and receiving their Aggie rings. Some of those future Aggies join us tonight, learning the ropes of how we do muster. However, there is not only the distant future to consider, but also an imminent future. It is a future that anticipates tomorrow and the days that will follow soon after. It is a future that we can immediately shape and impact in powerful ways by helping to preserve and promote this university's most valuable resource, its people. Our existing and potential relationships hold tremendous power. Often all that is needed to ignite this potential is one compassionate word or action, an answer to the needs of those around us. As a faculty member, I encounter many students who are struggling in significant ways. Through my experiences and those of others I know, I'm also aware of faculty and staff who are in great need of connection with someone who will show them compassion. Academic life for students and faculty alike can be an experience that is lonely, uncertain, anxiety-inducing, and even clinically depressing. Serious hunger among college students is a growing reality across the nation. It is becoming more common for students at Texas A&M and elsewhere to skip meals repeatedly because they lack money for food. College expenses, even at public universities like ours, are an increasingly bigger source of significant stress for first-generation students, students estranged from their families, and students and families in the midst of major life challenges. Despite budgeting and planning, one unforeseen event can result in financial chaos and threaten academic goals. Many students feel academically stranded because the high school study skills that were sufficient to gain them admission here deliver only failure and disappointment in their courses. These students become embarrassed, frustrated, and doubt that they belong. Contractors, such as the custodial staff and food service workers serving in the Aggie community, sometimes feel that they vanish into the background, unacknowledged, underappreciated, and unworthy. Statistics from the National Institute of Mental Health document the likelihood of individuals seriously considering suicide and point us to troubling realizations. During the coming year, over 3,000 undergraduate students, 500 graduate students, 300 staff members, and 100 of our faculty are likely to contemplate taking their own life. Additionally, about half of them will never plan to tell anyone about it. Suicide risk continues to climb every year. The transformational power of personal, caring relationships is the most effective means to fight against this. While we fulfill our given roles as students, staff, faculty, leaders, team members, and family, we can make a difference by showing compassion and offering relationship. Compassion is a rich concept. It begins with empathy, that desire to understand the circumstances of others around us and to be touched by the emotions they are experiencing. But compassion surpasses empathy, culminating in caring action and committed involvement. If you've ever gotten your next several meals from the 12th canned food pantry, you've received compassion. If you've worked with the student organization Carpool to provide a free, non-judgmental ride home to a community member who is not safe to drive, you've practiced compassion. If you've ever been in crisis in the middle of the night and talked to a student staffer on the Student Counseling Services helpline, you've felt compassion. If you've ever seen something troubling in a friend's eye, then invited them to sit for a moment and vent, you have extended compassion. Compassion is not listed among the Aggie core values of excellence, integrity, leadership, loyalty, respect, and selfless service. But compassion is there, hidden inside each aspiration. Without compassion, our core values would not be admirable. They would be hollow shells without heart. Promoting and tending healthy interpersonal relationships also requires an ongoing commitment. Day by day and year by year, we must build bridges between our differences and emphasize our commonalities. We must respond with compassion when we detect signs of distress and trouble. For as we are faithful to do this tomorrow and in the days following, we will find that we also influence the distant future. The Aggies of today and tomorrow will be observing us and learning from our examples. By valuing relationships within our community, our imminent future will shape the more distant future of the Aggie family across time. Therefore, each of us is valuable. Each of us is important. The fact that I am the one speaking to you tonight is a humbling illustration of the power of an ordinary life that can be transformed by the compassion of others. We are all transformed. We all have the potential to transform others. We may not be wealthy, but we are rich in the personal relationships in which we invest. We may not have prestige, but we can be powerful because of the influence granted by those who trust us. We may not be famous, but we will be well known to those who have invited us to share in parts of their lives. Our past, present, and future relationships are what knit us together. In both remembrance and celebration, in both extending and receiving compassion, we should be humbled and challenged by being part of the Aggie family. We can look back at many examples set by those who have now gone from us. We can notice and appreciate those in the Aggie family who are investing in our lives right now. In the coming days, we can pledge to practice leadership through kindness, excellence through caring, loyalty to our shared humanity, selfless service through intentional availability, respect through trustworthiness, integrity through authenticity. Those whose names will be called tonight, including our beloved 41st president and his wife, are cherished members of that family who modeled for us the core values through their acts of compassion. We will remember these for years to come. Let these memories and this charge cause us to rise up as thousands of points of light at this university and in the world around us, shining with a bright and welcoming compassion. By doing this, we honor the living and also those members of the Aggie family that have gone before us and whose lives we honor tonight. Through these relationships and memories, we will strengthen the foundations and the impact of this institution, along with the many, many lives that are and will be Texas A&M. Thank you.
Please be seated. Roll call for the absent. In many lands and climes this April day, proud sons of Texas A&M unite. Our loyalty to country, school we pray, and seal our pact with bond of common might. We live again those happy days of yore on campus, field, in classroom, hall, at drill. Fond memory brings a sigh, but nothing more. Now we are men, and life is one great thrill. On Fortress Isle, 77 years ago today, a group of gallant Aggies, led by Moore, held simple rites which to us all doth say, "The spirit shall prevail, or a cannon roar." They thought of home and all we hold most dear. Where are they now, those boys we knew so well? Ask of the winds, let smile repress a tear. think only of their glory when they fell. Corregidor, forevermore a hallowed name, to countless sons of Texas yet unborn, symbolic-like, it stands for deathless fame, a shrine sublime till resurrection morn. Softly call the muster, let comrade answer here, their spirits hover around us as if to bring us cheer. Mark them present in our hearts, we'll meet some other day. There is no death but life eternal for heroes such as they.
Will the candle holders please rise? Joseph William Little, class of 2022. Eric Kyle Hansen, class of 2021. Grant Jackson Hernandez, class of 2021. Andrew Keith Kalinka, class of 2021. Sophie Pearl Rosenberg, class of 2021. Anne Pulliam Kalinka, class of 1991. Here, here. Anna Dryden Wegener, class of 2021. Here, here. Emily Lynn Chaffin, class of 2020. Here, here. Hannah Michalski, class of 2020. Here, here. Mirzad Monzavi, class of 2020. Thomas Pierce Followill, class of 2019. Here. Montgomery Gano, class of 2019. Here. Noah Joseph Gunhouse, class of 2019. Van Lee, class of 2019. Here. Adolfo Payan Jr., class of 2019. Here. Alan Chong Tan, class of 2019.
Specialist Trevor William Lynch, class of 2018. Mark Christopher Wilson, class of 2018. Harrison Matthew Hughes, class of 2017. Evan Andrew Smith, class of 2017. Kaylee Brooke Maddox, class of 2016. Kristen Lane Moss, class of 2015. Sarah Leanne Sappington, class of 2015. Dr. Mary Elizabeth Springs, class of 2015. Michael J. Whitehead, class of 2014. Matthew Michael Weiss, class of 2014. Sergeant Chuck Franklin Clayton, class of 2007. Dr. Wally Atisha, class of 1997. Jennifer Lynn Faltis, class of 1996. Brent Wesley Gaddis, class of 1995. Jason Douglas Carter, class of 1993. Marla Stevenson Pullen, class of 1993. Peggy Keys Schaefer, class of 1990. Becky Ann Elbert, class of 1982. Sergeant John Kernis Hennigan, class of 1982. Donald Eugene Brem, class of 1981. Here. Rodney Monroe Starnes, class of 1981. Here. Dr. Christopher Lynn Reed, class of 1980. Richard A. Berry, class of 1979. Lieutenant Colonel Ernest Lee Leon Smith, Jr., class of 1978. Peter John Thomas, class of 1978. Dr. Jesse Koch, Jr., class of 1976. Larry Norman Moore, class of 1975. Dr. V. O. Spites, class of 1975. Dr. Wendell Arnold, class of 1969. Wallace Marcus Mark Benedict Jr., class of 1969. Jimmy Jim Henry Brandenberger, class of 1969. Floyd W. Bridges, class of 1969. Jack H. Chancey, class of 1969. Lloyd M. Childress, class of 1969. Jim Dupree, class of 1969. Dr. Larry Zayuk, class of 1969. Lieutenant Colonel John D. Godfrey III, class of 1969. Gary S. Grenade, class of 1969. Douglas Ray Helm, Sr., class of 1969. Paul J. Henderson, class of 1969. James L. Hawley, class of 1969. Gordon R. Hyatt, class of 1969. Louis M. Igo, class of 1969. Richard Jacobson, class of 1969. Gary Frank Kitchens, class of 1969. Paul W. Landry, class of 1969. Lieutenant Colonel Willard R. Mumford, class of 1969. Larry G. Parsons, class of 1969. Ed Phillips, class of 1969. John E. Ray, class of 1969. Dr. Harry L. Rook, class of 1969. Lance M. Schaefer, class of 1969.
DeWard Strong, class of 1969. Albert J. Whipple III, class of 1969. Captain Gregory L. Wood, class of 1969. Santiago Jaime de los Santos, class of 1968. Edward Lee Hollihan III, class of 1968. Charles Red McGinty, class of 1968. George Richard Spengel, class of 1968. John Michael Sego, class of 1966. Lieutenant Colonel William Terrence Lane, class of 1965. John Craig Beckmeyer, class of 1964. Dr. Floron Clayton Buddy Ferris, Jr., class of 1964. Here. Ari Merritt, class of 1964. Here. Jerry Lynn Partridge, class of 1964. Warren W. Herman, class of 1963. L. Edward Berry, class of 1962. Dr. Robert Bauer, Jr., class of 1961. A.C. Hill, class of 1961. William Rhett Howerton, class of 1961. Dr. Benito Flores, class of 1960. Frank S. Glenn, class of 1960. Winston Wayne Lair, class of 1960. H.B. Buddy Payne, class of 1960. Kenneth Irwin Faulkner, class of 1959. Sydney Pitts, class of 1959. Wilburn C. Smith, class of 1959. James Paul Murray, class of 1958. Dr. James Carter Cooper, class of 1956. Dr. Raymond Arthur Dietrich, class of 1956. Here. Kenneth M. Hankins, class of 1956. Here. Warren E. Martin, class of 1956. Here. Dr. Donald Joe Anderson, class of 1955. Donald David Bone, class of 1955. Here. Garrett Wortham Maxwell, class of 1955. Here. David Klein Stickler, class of 1955. Dr. James H. Earle, class of 1954. Here. Blassie Philip Pantuso, class of 1954. Here. Major General Charles Reese Cargill, class of 1953. Robert Truett Childress, Jr., class of 1953. Here. Joe Ed Harris, class of 1953. Here. Dr. Horace W. Van Cleve, class of 1952. Ben L. Chambers, class of 1951. Here. Edward Thomas Templin, Jr., class of 1951. Here. Charles William Rogers, class of 1949. Ed M. Farrow, class of 1947. Here. The Honorable Israel Allen Lerner, class of 1947. Here. Albert James Springs, class of 1947. Paul Eugene Napper, class of 1946. Here. James E. Wiley, Sr., class of 1946. Gary Eugene Napper, class of 1971. Here. James L. Powell, class of 1944. James Posey Alford, class of 1943. Ralph Emerson Turner, class of 1928. Dr. Clark Edward Adams. Dr. Judy Ball. Here, here. Zerl L. Carpenter. Here, here. Dr. Henry C. Detloff. Here, here. Dr. Harris J. Granger. Here. Barry Nelson Jackson. Dr. M. Sam Menon. Here. Distinguished Professor John J. McDermott. Here. Dr. Robert Daniel Rakoff. Dr. Donald L. Riddell. Here. Dr. Kenneth F. Reinschmidt. Here. Dr. Winston T. Sharon. Dr. Lawrence P. Wilding. Here. Dr. T. Hsu. Here. Janine Pulley Fowler, class of 1986. Walter Mosley Jr., class of 1948. Dr. Wendell Horn, class of 1965. John T. Ritter II, class of 1969.
Former First Lady Barbara Pierce Bush.
Former President George Herbert Walker Bush. Mark these names forever in our hearts.
Please extinguish your flame and be seated. In Memoriam by Lieutenant Colonel David Harrigan, class of 1968. We stood a little taller and a little prouder then, when we heard the call of muster and the roll call just begin. We stood there all together and wiped away the tears, when our names were called out softly and answered with a hear. And so we've joined together with our brothers of the past to make our final resting place at Aggieland, our last. We take a toast to our brotherhood, wherever they may roam. For us, the trek is over. Aggieland, we're coming home.
In 1942, E.E. McClellan, Executive Secretary of the Association of Former Students and Class of 1920, sent a message to the chairman of each Aggie Muster worldwide. In this message was included a traditional closing of the ceremony that has remained an integral part of many musters to this day. Professor Robert Segner, Class of 1969, will now stand and dismiss the muster. Sir, the 2019 campus muster at Texas A&M University is now complete.
I charge you each to remain firm in your loyalty to humanity and to your country. Keep warm in your hearts your affection for each other and for your alma mater. The muster is dismissed until April 21st, 2020. And may good fortune smile upon us until we meet again.